model with ancient Bitum and modern RPC protocols in mind. There are many important keywords in this slide, so I'm gonna decompose it into multiple sections. So first of all, it is an asynchronous framework. Are you familiar with asynchronous programming already, or have you ever tried to write a synchronous application before? Raise your hand. Wow, that's a lot. Unexpectedly. So why is a synchronous programming model important in microservices? I think you're all familiar with this. So let me be really quick. So let's start from a very typical synchronous microservice, which receives a bunch of requests from the clients and accesses many shards of the backends for the clients. In this case, we usually split the backends into many shards, like the right side of this diagram. So based on the request, the service will determine which request should go to which shard. In this diagram, a green request goes to a green shard, and a blue request goes to a blue shard, and so on. And there are a bunch of worker threads, in this case, four threads, and they drain the pending requests from a task queue and performs the actual access. And the shards, as shown in the diagram, they are all performing really well and everything is good. However, let's say one of the shards started to fail, responding very late. In this case, the shard number 2. How often will this kind of failure happen in a large scale system? Does anyone know? It will, like every day, actually, because there are many shards in the system and the machine is destined to fail. Because of the failure, the thread two will take much longer than usual to handle the request for shard number 2. At the beginning, this doesn't seem to be a big deal because all other threads are handling the request for other shards very well. In this case, shard number 1 and 3, they are all good. However, even if shard 1 and 3 are responding quickly, it is only a matter of time for most worker threads to get busy handling the request for the shard 2 because it takes majority of time for handling the request. As a result, they do not give a room for handling other requests. Unless shard 2 is recovered really quickly, the worker threads are dominated by shard 2, and other shards will be affected regardless of whether they are capable of handling requests or not. So what does all this mean? Just a single partial failure in your system can trigger the entire service to go down. So how could we solve this problem? Of course, we cannot add more CPUs because adding CPUs does not help this problem. Because if you look into the system is actually not spending a lot of CPUs. It just waits for the backend to respond. And you could also think about adding more threads to the thread pool, but this is not a good idea either, because no matter how many threads you add, it will actually really quickly get busy with handling the request for the shard number 2 because they are dominating. And of course, there are some other workarounds, like having different worker threads for each shard. For example, for the shard number 1, we could have worker thread pool number 1 and shard number 2 worker thread pool 2, like that. But we cannot do this kind of hacky workarounds because the system configuration can change anytime, and whenever such change happens, you have to reconfigure your service, and it's gonna be pretty inconvenient in reality. solve this problem, we will need to introduce asynchronous programming in our microservices. And that's why we chose asynchronous programming model. And the second one is now we know why asynchronous programming is programming model is important, but it is not the only case we need to build a robust microservice. It has to be reactive. Have you ever heard of reactive strings before? Reactive strings. Oh, okay. Again, a lot more than I expected. So Armeria implements reactive strings API, which is a de facto standard for streaming data reactively in JVM ecosystem. So have you ever heard of libraries like RxJava or Project Reactor or Spring Webflux? Okay, they are actually reactive streams API implementation. So even if you are not aware of reactive streams API, but if you ever heard of these products, you might still be using reactive streams API. And because they all implement this reactive streams API, we are interoperable with them very easily. But why do we need to be reactive? Why does it matter? Because it helps your service not blow up with out of memory error, under load, or handling a large amount of data. For example, let's say we have to send 10 megabytes of personalized response to each of 100,000 clients at the same time. If you do some simple calculation, you cannot hold them in RAM at once because it's 1 terabyte. You have to stream it, like sending it chunk by chunk. So if we stream the data, we have to be cautious about the speed of data production. If we send it too fast, the client will not catch up. In that case, the data will be buffered on the server side, and then eventually the server will get out of memory error again. Reactive streams solve this problem very nicely, and that's why we chose that API as our core mechanism of streaming requests or responses. And now, modern libraries. Many microservice frameworks, including Armeria, is based on HTTP, but it doesn't mean that it is supported by RESTful APIs. It doesn't mean that it supports only RESTful APIs. There are many various compelling alternatives to REST in microservice architecture, and one of them is the RPC protocols like gRPC and Strict. At Line, we use Strict extensively with Armeria for communicating with microservices, and also companies like Slack, the chat-based communication collaboration web service, they also use Armeria for gRPC calls. So why is Armeria special for RPC, and why other companies also choose it for their RPC? This is a simple example of usual RPC call over HTTP, which has failed at business logic level. So if you look into the response on the right side, HTTP status of the response is 200 okay, which means success, ironically, because it has failed. It is pretty common for RPC protocols to use 200 okay and put the actual result into the response box. HTTP-based frameworks often do not provide information like method name and parameter names and values and return values or exception intro or RPC calls. They do not expose them. So they are hidden under the color. You have to decode the binary part of the response. I call this problem an impedance mismatch between RPC and HTTP. So how about access logs? If you look into the access log file written by application server, barely get what you want. What if we provide access logs with the universal API or gRPC strict and REST, and provide RPC level information like parameter names and values and return values, etc., and also with precise and receive timings, all programmatically. For example, when the request was sent and received, and response was sent and received, and any other timing information are missing in this single access log line, but we have all those information, so it would be nice if you can access such information, right? So let's imagine you stream this information into your data processing pipeline via Kafka or some other streaming solutions, and you do some further analysis of them later from those events, it will be pretty cool. Another long-standing issue of RPC is that it is often hard to make an ad hoc call, like sending an RPC request without any ID setup. So far, we have to find the proper service definition file, such as .drift or .proto file, and set up the development environment, like build tools and IDE, and then write some code, and then make some actual RPC call by yourself. It basically takes a lot of energy. In contrast, for HTTP, you can just use a tool like a CURL or even Telnet to send a simple request by yourself to reproduce a request you want to send. But with gRPC, it is still not very convenient. So we made something that's more convenient and more collaborative in our area. I'm going to show you a little bit later. Also, as far as I know, our area is currently the only framework that supports both the gRPC and Thrift, and lets you serve both of them in a single TCP IP port and in a single JVM. Of course, without using any proxy servers like HAProxy and Linkerd, etc. It's actually not just gRPC and TripNet too. For example, you can even serve non-gRPC requests together. You can serve RESTful API, you can also serve static files, and even you can expose Prometheus metrics using their exposition API, and you can also respond to help check requests from your load balancers. You can even serve the traditional Java EE web applications, usually runs on top of Tomcat or Jetty, without opening an extra TCP IP port or without using any extra load balancer in front of all these servers. So let's imagine you have both gRPC and RESTful endpoint for the same business load. It means much less burden of your operation, server operation, because you have much less number of components to manage. Right. And this is the last part of what our memory is, user friendliness. Did you ever have a poor experience when using a certain library? Let's say there are two libraries which do the same job, but some libraries are more popular than the other. It happens really often when some library has more user-friendly API and documentation, while the other lacks documentation or they have some unintuitive API. So we try to do our best to make you happy with using it. So when we say UX, user experience, it's often about front-end applications, but it's not. UX is not only important for end users, but also very important for ourselves, the developers. Of course. So nobody wants to use a framework that's bad, unintuitive, or hard to use, right? Especially when there are plenty of choices in the market. So one of the goals when we designed our Armeria was to do our best to give you the best experience ever, as much as possible. So yeah, especially when building our services. So we try to make it as user friendly as possible and as try to make sure it has smooth learning curve. So did we succeed to deliver feature rich yet user friendly API? You will find out. So we visited the every element that makes our what our memory is. To summarize a little bit, it is the result of our effort to build a user friendly and RPC aware, asynchronous and reactive microservice framework. We built it on top of Netty to provide the best asynchronous programming experience and performance. And it implements React Script API, and it is interoperable with other frameworks and libraries like RxJava and Project Reactor and Spring Webflex. It also lets you mix and match different service types in a single server, running gRPC and Tomcat, REST, whatever, in a single server without any operational burden. So far we summarized what Armenia is, and I'm going to show you some examples which are pretty simple. So here is the Hello World example. We have server builder, we use builder patterns, and we specify the HTTP port and HTTPS port, and there's also, because we do HTTPS, we have to specify a certificate, right? So we specify a certificate, but in this case, when we develop an application, casually, we usually do not really want to purchase a certificate or generate a real certificate, right? So we usually generate a self-signed certificate. So in this case, we provided a simple utility method for that, so you do not have to generate a certificate file by yourself. And because we also support HAProx protocol, we specified HAProx protocol at port 8080. And now we call the service method, which binds a service at the root directory of the server. And the service is usually represented as a Lambda expression. In this case, it always responds with Hello World response. But what's interesting is that HTTP and HAProxy uses the same port. Usually, if you do something like this, then the server will fail to start because you specify the same port number for two different protocols because they conflict with each other. But in our area, we do protocol automatic detection. So let's say you have some very strict firewall restriction, so you're not allowed to open many ports. In that case, you can reuse a single port to serve many different protocols, for example, HTTP, HTTPS, and HAProx. But in reality, you are going to have to do some path mapping, right? Like, so you can have some input and make your service respond to that input. So here, we specify the path variable called the name. And the name can be accessed via context object using the path param method. But some of you might not familiar with this kind of Lambda expression based pattern, but more used to the pattern of using annotations, like using something like this. So we used an annotation here. So there's a get annotation with path mapping, and we annotated our hello method with a param annotation here. So because the name parameter in get annotation and parameter name, method parameter name, name matches with each other, right? In that case, it is automatically injected here. And then there's a format method call, which formats the response message. What's interesting is that we do not return a response object, but just a simple string. They are automatically converted just like other web frameworks. So, there are many features available, but as you know, all these features are actually also available in other reactive web frameworks, but the point is we have matching feature set with other web frameworks. So if there is anything missing in our work, just let us know and we will be very happy to add any missing features. And of course we do gRPC and Drift. So have you ever worked with Drift or gRPC before? Raise your hand. So to write a gRPC or a Drift services, you have to write some service definition file, like all those syntax highlighted text. So here on the left side, it is a Drift hello world service, and on the right side, it's a gRPC hello service. It's pretty straightforward. You receive a name request, and you receive you send a response which contains a hello message. So for gRPC, it's pretty much same with the REST services. So you build a server using the builder pattern, and unlike HTTP RESTful service, we use gRPC service here. And on the bottom, there's a class called MyHello service. It's basically the implementation of what gRPC generated. So you hear hello service info base is an abstract class, and you implement it. In this case, the method hello is an abstract method. For gRPC, it's pretty much the same, but in this case, you use the key HTTP service. So what our Maria server does, it depends entirely on what service you add. If you add gRPC service, it becomes a gRPC service. If you add Drift service, it becomes a Drift server. And if you add RESTful service, then it becomes a REST server. But you might want to know why you have to use our Maria for writing your RPC service. Because for gRPC, there's an official gRPC implementation, and there's also an official Drift server and client implementation already. Why should we use our Maria? It's because we have more bells and whistles in our Maria, of course. For example, for gRPC, our Maria works on both HTTP 1 and 2, unlike gRPC upstream implementation. And also we have built-in gRPC web support. gRPC web support is a way to send a gRPC request from your web browser. So let's say there's a web browser and your service, and there are some other services. Usually you can use gRPC between the services inside your network, but when you communicate with your customers, like browsers and apps, then in between these connections, you usually use other different protocols, like REST API. But using gRPC web, you can also use gRPC between web browsers and your services, which means you can use all same protocols all the way from web browser to your internal services, which can be a big benefit. And also for Drift, the official JavaScript implementation does not have support for HTTP 2. It only supports HTTP 1, but our implementation supports HTTP biggest advantage of using Armeri is that you can mix and match different services, gRPC script, RESTful API, Tomcat, Jetty, whatever, you can merge them into a single server. And we also have some additional interesting features I'm going to show you real soon. So there's a decorator. Let me show you this first. Here we created a script call service, and then we decorated with the decorator here, and then decorated it with THTT service. In this case, when a request comes in, the last decorator will be evaluated first, and then the decorator in the middle will be evaluated, and then your business logic will be evaluated. So by doing this, you can you have an access to all the RPC protocol information, RPC request information, like method name, parameters, and return value as shown in this example. What's even more interesting is that you can even filter out the parameters or methods as you wish. For example, let's say if a user does not have enough privilege to exact a certain operation, you can filter them out here. Or you can do some additional validation for security reasons. And you can do that at using a decorator. And also, decorator is not only for your intercepting requests, but also for providing Armeria's core mechanisms, like drop request throttling, or metric collection, distributed tracing, content encoding, like compressing and decompressing requests and responses, and also authorization and CORs, and it even implements circuit breakers and automatic retries on the client side. So here, this is an example of doing distributed tracing with Zipkin using Decorator. Here we used a service instance called My Service, and we decorated it with Brave Service. By adding a decorator to your service, it simply enables an advanced, highly advanced feature very easily. And as I told you in the beginning of this session, I said it is very hard to send an RPC request easily, right? Documentation service is the service that solved the problem. So it can be enabled by adding doc service into the server, and then it will automatically discover all the RPC services and RESTful API services, and then provide a user interface for accessing them. It supports gRPC script and annotation-based web services currently. And in the future, we are going to add more features like adding a metric browser and also add some dashboard for modifying runtime configuration like login level. So here's the screenshot of documentation service. On the left side, there's a list of services and their service operations. And if you choose an operation, in this case, add, on the right side, it will show the details about the service method. So there's a list of parameters and their types and return types, etc. And what's more interesting is on the bottom of the right side, you will be given with this text form, which allows you to write and send a request you want to send. So with this service, you do not really have to set up any build tools, or you do not really need to look for the service definition file, or you don't even need to set up any ID, because you can just type some request and press the button, then the request will be sent and the response will be shown on the right side. And also, if you look at the location field of the web browser, the location will be shown with the location will have the request encoded, right? So if you copy and paste the URL, If you share this URL with your colleagues, like saying, hey, it seems like I found some bug in your service, and if I send this request to the server, then it responds with something weird. Then you can share this URL with your friend, and your friend can just click the URL and it can easily produce the problem, right? But previously, it was not very easy to do that, and the developer of the service had to write some code to reproduce the problem, and it was time consuming. You don't have to do that. So, yeah. And we also have some client-side support. It basically has the same API, and we have some additional features like client-side circuit breakers and automatic retries and client-side load balancing. So here's a big example, but I'm gonna explain this to you later after this session is over, because there are not much time left. Okay. So far, if you are interested, please give it a try. Please feel free to ask me questions. I'm gonna be in the booth on the right side of this lecture room. So please feel free to come to me at line booth to ask some questions. And you can also ask questions at our Slack channel or GitHub repository, because we use our GitHub repository as a way to ask questions. So just create an issue and ask questions here. And also, if you find any missing features, just let us know by asking for it. And if you have a chance, please give it a try and tell me what is good, what was good, and what was bad, so we can fix it. And if you're really interested, we could even work together. So here's our QR code for our GitHub repository. GitHub repository location is line/armaria. And we also have some official website, so it has more documentation, and it also has the slide of this presentation. And yeah, so see you in the booth, and thank you for listening.
Okay, let's thank Swastini. Does anyone have questions? I think we can open one questions. Okay, I have a small question. Is Armaria already widely used in my...
Yes, it is used by many projects at Line. For example, we recently opened a service called OpenChat, which is a kind of anonymous chatting service. And we built that service from ground up using Armaria. And also, we migrated our legacy service, Sticker Shop. In app, Line app, you can buy Line stamps and emojis. That service has been migrated from Tomcat-based service to Armaria entirely, and they are fully synonymous.
Thank you. Okay, 我刚刚问他说那个LINE里面大概有没有广泛使用，他说目前已经很广泛，然后有一些像是那个匿名聊天的一个服务。 然后还有让大家比较常见的那个贴图小铺，就是卖贴图的那些服务，都是已经在用Armaria了。好，那我们这一场就到这边结束，谢谢各位。
Oh, and don't forget to start. Thank you.